Welcome to another part of lecture on designing organic syntheses. Subject of today are carbon heteroatom atom bonds as strategic bonds. Especially CO, CN, and CS bonds are often to be regarded as strategic bonds since they are rather easy to make, nucleophilic substitution reactions in general. So, let's start with one example. This one, a dichlorophenyl amide. In fact, this is an early herbicide. And let's think about the retrosynthetic analysis. Well, let's discuss first the disconnection of this CN bond and systematically we would now start with the synthons. As a synthon here in this position, we would need an acceptor reactivity, and on the other hand, we would prefer a donator reactivity here, since this amide moiety would be easy to deprotonate there, and then we have, of course, the nitrogen as an anionic nucleophilic center. So, this is no problem, since we can translate that into the propargylic amide as the substrate to be used, reagent to be used, just deprotonate, as I said, and acceptor reactivity. Wow. We can just put on an X as a leaving group. Of course, there is a problem. As you know, SN2 and SN1 type reactions don't work at sp2 hybridized centers. And here a substitution would be a nucleophilic aromatic substitution. This works best if you have, for instance, some nitrile groups attached in addition. Then it could work. Here you have a problem. You don't want to have the arene mechanism of the nucleophilic aromatic substitution. So, directly just deprotonating here, putting it together with, for instance, X-bromide wouldn't work. However, transition metal catalysis or transition metal induction can help to solve the problem, open up another reaction pathway, and copper catalyzed, or sometimes copper induced, that is an Ullmann coupling process, in that case it works. And meanwhile, there are also some palladium catalyzed reaction conditions known, mainly developed by Buchwald and Hartwig at MIT and Yale. These are very well known reactions, meanwhile. So these would work, and you get hands on that compound. So, as I said, this is a rather early herbicide, and therefore they certainly didn't make use of these type of reaction conditions for the synthesis. They certainly had another way. Let's analyze further. Maybe we get the idea. So, let's see, what about R2? So in that case, here donator reactivity, and on the other hand, acceptor reactivity here as synthons. Well, we can save some time in just translating, for instance, that chloride, or better, let's put on better an X. And X could be a chloride, but also could be a carboxylate. So that would mean we would apply an anhydride instead of a chloride. And for industrial purposes, large-scale reactions, well, an anhydride very often is far better, because you avoid the formation of HCl or some salts, you know. So, and here, simply applying that aniline. So an acylation of an aniline with an anhydride, carboxylic acid anhydride as a reagent is no problem at all, standard reaction. So now this is classical retrosynthetic analysis you have already learned in OC2. So if we start with aniline and we try a chlorination, then we would get para and ortho selectivity, and we would have some problems in stopping the reaction, because well, normally you get multiple chlorinations in that case. But on the other hand, well, better introducing the amino group, and having in mind we cannot introduce that directly, but in another oxidation state. So let's interconvert that functional group, simply changing the oxidation state. Well, at this retrosynthetic step we call functional group interconversion. And now it's easy to simplify this intermediate, and it's just a nitration reaction. So, with our retrosynthetic analysis, we just got back to the orthodichlorobenzene, and this is of course a reduction step. Now you might say, well, isn't that a problem? How do we get selective that ortho dichlorobenzene? Well, you don't get that selective by direct chlorination. However, as it turns out, if you do the chlorination of benzene, this is remarkably unselective. You have a lot of para dichlorobenzene besides quite a good amount, similar amount of that ortho dichloro and somewhat less the meta dichloro compound. You get a mixture, but you can separate that mixture, for instance, by distillation or crystallization. No problem. And if you do that as a company on a large scale, and you need preferentially this one, you might also find an application for that one. And this was mainly the solution of a problem at that time. Yeah? Finding applications for all isomers, okay. And then it's not a problem that you don't get that selectively, since this is a rather cheap process, the direct chlorination of benzene. As an exercise, please try the retrosynthetic analysis. Of this target molecule. Okay, systematically, if we want to define our synthons, we would, for instance, disconnect here and have acceptor reactivity, donator reactivity. Nevertheless, no problem in first of all writing down this type of acid, phthalic acid, but later on thinking about the reactivity of that. And on the other hand, that tertiary alcohol. Well, directly treating those together under the influence maybe of some sulfuric acid will cause some problems, since that tertiary alcohol in benzylic position will tend to will show a tendency for an elimination reaction from an olefin here. Yeah. You need something more reactive here. In fact, what is, I think, even cheaper as that, if you can buy that at all, is the anhydride. This is the hydrolysis product of the anhydride. And the anhydride has a sufficient reactivity of directly reacting with a tertiary alcohol, and if you add, for instance, some base, then for sure the reaction will work. Those two together. So, why is this so cheap? How is this anhydride produced? Maybe some of you remember that was also part of organic chemistry too. Oxidation of naphthalene with molecular oxygen, think at a silver contact at higher temperatures, then you oxidize one of those rings. Here you have two electron-rich rings, far more easy to oxidize than this one, where those carbonyl groups mesomerically diminish the electron density here. Yeah? Therefore, you can stop the reaction at this oxidation state. So, molecular oxygen as the oxidizing agent, naphthalene as the substrate, and with some technical tricks like silver catalyst, heterogeneous catalyst, then it works. Short contact gas phase and catalyst, that's the way to do it. Because of course you can further oxidize that, but this literally means burning it, yeah, until you have CO2, okay? So, well, we should have a look at that one, how to synthesize this. Well, okay, donator reactivity. Acceptor reactivity here, and these synthons are then translated to acetophenone and, for instance, an ethyl guanine reagent. Well, and if we would analyze, how do we get this one, okay, acetophenone you can buy, but it is made by a Friedel-Crafts acylation, of course. Next example. A very simple one. It is part of a perfume oil. Please analyze this one. Certainly easy to figure out the retrosynthesis or synthetic plan then for that, but maybe it's a bit more difficult to figure out which way to synthesize that is the best one. Because, well, you have on the first glimpse the choice, disconnecting here or disconnecting there. So please try to figure out which one is the better one. In this case, the retrosynthetic analysis is straightforward. Let us just write down the preferred starting material. Here, either the benzyl chloride or the benzyl bromide, and an alcoholate as the nucleophile, that sodium alcoholate, for instance, or on the other hand, R2. We have the sodium alcoholate of the benzylic alcohol, and again a leaving group X here. So which one is better? Well, presumably you would try to avoid the tosylate as the leaving group, because then the leaving group has already more molecular mass than that part you want to transfer. So in the context of atom economy, this is not a good idea in that case. Well, actually, there's a simple reason why this should be preferred. In that second case, you have a potential competing reaction which you don't have there, the elimination reaction. You have an alkoxylate, it could induce an elimination reaction, E2 elimination reaction. Here, an elimination reaction is not possible. So, that means you presumably have a much cleaner reaction in this case. Well, let's have a look at some difunctional target molecules. For instance, 1,1 difunctional. An easy example, simple example, is this one, just an acetal. You have two functionalities at one carbon, two ether functionalities, and overall we call that an acetal. Yeah? And of course you know how to make these. An acid catalyzed acetylization. Another example for 1,1 difunctionalized targets are amino acids. There are, of course, several ways for synthesizing amino acids. One possible way is in the retrosynthetic analysis, functional group interconversion, to convert that acid into an acid derivative. For instance, a cyano group, a hydrolysis. Of a cyano group under somewhat harsh reaction conditions will deliver a carboxylic acid here, and finally then this amino acid. So, and one could imagine that this can be formed in a three-component reaction where you have an aldehyde, HCN, and NH3. Or a primary amine, then you would have an additional substituent there. Yeah? So, condensation to an imine, and then, protonation by that and the cyano group attacks as a nucleophile. Well, this kind of reaction is known since, I think, 1850 or so. It's the Strecker synthesis. The Strecker synthesis of amino acids. A 1,2 difunctional compound or target, 1,2 difunctional. For instance, this type of amino alcohol. Also in this case, can be a good idea to, for applying a functional group interconversion, while in this case also changing the oxidation state. For instance, this one. This leads then back to the starting compound, cyclohexanone, and well, HCN, or maybe using a potassium cyanide and later on acidifying. So in this case we have changed the oxidation state of that carbon from here to there, and here we have simply a reduction. But one could also, thinking about just changing the oxidation state of that nitrogen here, also not a bad idea. Again, you would start from cyclohexanone. Applying, in this time, nitromethane under basic reaction conditions. This would be a nitroaldol addition reaction. So, nitroaldol addition. Just by the way, this is an interesting substrate for a rearrangement process. You might already know the Tiffenol rearrangement. Aqueous diluted HCl, and sodium nitrite, forming the nitrosyl cation and diazonium cation here at this position, and then the rearrangement reaction would take place, which leads to a ring enlargement, 7-membered ring member start from a six-membered ring. Few simple steps and get to the seven-membered ring. So this is an example of a Tiffenot rearrangement. Some other rather short retrosynthetic analyses. This one. Well, okay. Maybe this could also be an example for a very simple bidirectional analysis, because you can easily get the idea buying something that has these skeleton already, and this is antranilic acid. Yeah. So, and what you need, if you have already chosen antranilic acid as your starting material, you need a synthen with two acceptor positions side by side. Well, yes, it could be that 1,2-dibromoethane. On the other hand, well, one could also think about ethylene oxide. Of course, choosing then the right reaction conditions for that. You know, that is a gas, and you will first easily form the CN bond here, but then you have a secondary alcohol and you will have to form that seven-membered ring intramolecular esterification, maybe with phosphoxychloride induced. Yeah. Okay. But that was certainly easy. Let's analyze this structure together. It's called salbutamol, and it's a drug against asthma. So, of course, we could start with disconnecting here with the tertiary butyl group. Well, but certainly it's better, or on the first glimpse looks already somewhat better, since the synthesis gets a more convergent character if you disconnect there. So let's write that down. So, acceptor reactivity here, since with the amine you already have the denatural reactivity as the natural reactivity at this position. So tertiary butyl amine would be one reagent, of course. Now we have to look for synthetic equivalence of that one. Well, there is already an idea implied by that epoxide. So imagine you could translate that course in this, but with a base, presence of a base, which could eliminate HX, having this epoxide as an intermediate. While on the other hand, this should be rather sensitive. An epoxide at a benzylic position, it opens up rather easily, and this benzylic cation is then even better stabilized by the mesomeric stabilization with that phenol group. Okay? But it might not be that bad. On the other hand, we could change the oxidation state here. And we'll get to that structure within our retrosynthetic analysis. So, and for the synthesis, we can say, okay, we synthesize this first, then let that react with the aniline, with the tertiary butyl amine, then reduce the carbonyl group to the alcohol. It's not necessary directly reducing that to this structure and then letting that react with a nucleophile. Actually, if we need to introduce a reduction step, this might help to solve others' problems. For instance, where does this hydroxymethyl group derive from? You can introduce a hydroxymethyl group by a reaction called hydroxymethylation. a hydroxymethylation in the presence of this aceto group maybe won't work, since the hydroxymethylation could also proceed here. It's a simple aldol addition process followed by an aldol condensation. Yeah? And all those problems you can solve if you just get the idea that you can get an hydroxymethyl group by a reduction of a carboxylic acid. So you need to reduce this carbonyl group. Why not reducing another group, carboxylic acid, at the same time in one step, leading to that hydroxymethyl group? And then, having these ideas in mind, you will get to this structure. This can be synthesized. So the transformation from, well, you would first brominate here. Yeah, okay. Bromination here, then reaction with the tertiary butyl amine, having the amino group there, and then reducing with lithium aluminum hydride. And you will then already get to that structure. So very simple. And how to synthesize that? Well, okay. Here you have the moiety of salicylic acid, and you need an acetylation. You can indeed start from acetyl salicylic acid. You know this famous drug against headache. And think with aluminum chloride, you get that rearrangement done. Essentially, it's a Friedel-Crafts acetylation in para position of that phenol. The last retrosynthetic analysis for today, this time as an exercise, and as you will see, this is already strongly related to the salbutamol synthesis. This is an intermediate also in the synthesis of a drug for treating, I think, also asthma or similar diseases. Please try a retrosynthetic analysis. So following the idea that we have outlined already here with that amino alcohol, it's certainly a good idea to get the first disconnection here, right in the center, forming two parts of very similar size. So, and, well, to get a shortcut here, we just say, well, let's take the epoxide in this case. Also in this case, that epoxide is somewhat sensitive, but it's less sensitive as in the case of the salbutamol synthesis, since we have the phenol protected here. So, with In our age group here, it would be especially acidic, and we could get, well, an acid-driven ring opening there, forming a paraquinonoid intermediate, which then will tend to polymerize, for instance. Yeah? So these would be reactions which could occur, exemplifying the sensitivity of that system with an OH group here. Here with that benzyl-protected one, it's, of course, somewhat better, less sensitive. So, and on the other hand, this one. Well, unfortunately, synthesizing a drug for treating diseases which has chiral centers, we need it enantioselectively. So, how do we get that one enantioselectively? Company that synthesized it had the idea, well, we need that, getting it by reduction of a ketone, and they chose a nice way to separate the enantiomers. Just synthesizing the racemate, getting the acylated derivative, and treating that racemate with an enzyme, an esterase. And that enzyme will preferentially hydrolyze one of the enantiomeric esters. Okay? So then we got this one, and so on. Here, you see the similarity to the salbutamol stuff. Yeah, also in the salbutamol stuff, we had that bromo alpha bromo ketone. Yeah? Here also, in that synthesis plan. So now to this problem. In that case, they also synthesized the racemate and then separating the enantiomers via diastereoisomeric salts with a chiral carboxylic acid. You know that from our undergraduate lab. There you had that diamino cyclohexane and forming the salt with tartaric acid, okay, and separating those diastereoisomeric salts. So, how to synthesize a primary amine like that? One idea could be, we discussed that, a reductive amination, of that ketone, but certainly not a good idea for an industrial scale synthesis of that For instance, these two starting materials don't look favorable, at least not this one, the bromoacetone. In a case like that, you run into some problems with ideas as outlined as there. Just think about that what you need is that type of skeleton. And don't care about the oxidation state. Just change the oxidation state and everything might become very easy. For instance, let's change the oxidation state here at the amino group and also at those carbons. So, catalytic transition metal catalyst, the catalytic hydrogenation. And maybe you find even a chiral homogeneous catalyst which also does the hydrogenation enantioselectively here. And at the same time reducing also the nitro group. Maybe this type of catalyst already exists. Otherwise you try to develop it, okay? And if you don't get that enantioselectively, well, you can then nevertheless separate a racemic mixture. So, and how do we get this one? Well, that should be easy again. This is a nitro-aldol condensation in this direction. Anise or anisic aldehyde and nitroethane and sodium ethanolate in ethanol, heating it up a bit, this will work. Okay, finish for today. Thanks for listening. Have a nice weekend. Next lesson will take place on next Tuesday.